Good morning, Zion Church. What a beautiful resurrection morning. It's good to be with you, even though we're not together in the sanctuary. I've never experienced anything like this in my lifetime, and many of you, I'm sure, feel the same way. But we are together in spirit, and the Holy Spirit is with us no matter where we're at, whether we're here in the sanctuary or we're worshiping together in our living rooms. So God bless you today. It's good to see and be with each one of you. God bless you and have a wonderful time as we worship together.
Good morning, everybody. I'd like to read to you the weekly announcements. I had the pleasure of teaching on the Monday, Thursday Seder meal. You can find that on YouTube by searching OFTWYO on YouTube, or on our Facebook page, or from our website, zionchurchworland.org. Now, this was nothing less than Jesus and the Passover Seder meal, and it's a presentation of how those elements, and to some degree the order of that meal, point ultimately to the work and person of Jesus Christ, our Messiah. So I really encourage you to check it out. Please be watching for updates. They will be sent via email, our website, Facebook, and the weekly newsletter. If you would like to receive a newsletter from us, it can be found on our website. We also send them out via snail mail and email. Please contact our church if you would like to be added to one of those weekly lists. As a reminder, tithes and anything else that is mailed to our physical address will cause a delay in receiving it, or it will be returned to you. Please use Zion's P.O. Box 376, Worland 82401. That's P.O. Box 376, Worland 82401. Thank you very much. We really do appreciate it so that we may continue our ministries and serving you. Also, youth camp at Camp Bethel. For kids going into third grade through 12th grade, the first camp begins June 1st. We have not heard of any cancellations yet. And depending on the age of your youth, the different camps go through July. You can register and pay online at mountainexperience.org or click the Camp Bethel link on our website. Zion's offices are still open. We are here Monday through Thursday from 8:30 a.m. until 4:30 p.m. and Fridays until 1 p.m. If you need to contact us, please feel free to call at area code 307-347-2266. You can send us an email at zionchurch@rtconnect.net. Visit our Facebook page or contact us through the website zionchurchworld.org. Now, if you'll please join me for the call to worship. If you want to pause this and turn into your Bibles, it's Mark 16, 1 through 7. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go to anoint Jesus' body. Very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him? But go, tell his disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." Now, if you please join me for an opening prayer. Lord Father, thank you for bringing us together, if not in person, but at least through the power of your Holy Spirit. We would ask that each of us be filled with your presence, that we sense the presence of your Son, our Savior, and that in doing so, we feel connected to you, and ultimately, all of those who are filled with your Holy Spirit, our fellow brothers and sisters, and your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us to exalt him on this Easter morning. And please use that joy we feel this morning, the excitement we feel during this time of year of when your Son has risen from the dead, and carry that excitement on throughout the rest of the year. Let that feeling not just be for this time, but for all time. For we are looking towards the most incredible and awesome moment in history when your Son rose from the dead, conquered death, defeated sin, and provided a way for all of us to as well have eternal life. And these things we praise and ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, if you would please join me in the Apostles' Creed. Church, what is it that we believe? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the one holy universal Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now, if you would please join me in reciting the prayer that our Lord Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Next, we have a scripture reading from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 15, verses 21 through 38. A certain man from Cyrene, Simon, the father of Alexander and Rufus, was passing by on his way in from the country, and they forced him to carry the cross. They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. Then they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him. Dividing up his clothes, they cast lots to see what each would get. It was 9 in the morning when they crucified him. The written notice of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." They crucified 2 rebels with him, one at his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "So, you who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, come down from that cross and save yourself." In the same way, the chief priests and teachers of the law mocked him among themselves. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. Let this Messiah, this King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe." Those crucified with him also heaped insults on him. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And at 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing near heard this, they said, "Listen, he's calling Elijah." Someone ran, filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down," he said. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom.
You call me your mother, Jane.
Son. But as so many have been sharing, Lord, may we remember that while the churches are empty, so too is the tomb of your Son, Jesus Christ. For he is not in there anymore, Lord. Father, your arm has been revealed in your Son. He has demonstrated you to the world. He has kept the law perfectly. And yet, despite that, he is the one that took the punishments for the sin of mankind. He placed it upon himself, not just physical pain, but the pain of having done all those horrible things which have offended you of the entire world on his person on Good Friday. And then, Lord, you demonstrated your power, the power of Adonai, when he was raised again from the dead, and he overcame sin, proving that life is more powerful than death, that your righteousness and your rule is more powerful than evil and the power of Satan. Lord, we just want to thank you that your Son took our place, that he switched places with us so that we would be seen to have his righteousness because he took upon our sin. And Lord Father, we just want to thank you so much that by raising from the dead, your Son became a first fruits, a prime example, but also an indicative picture of what will happen to all those who have faith in him and have his righteousness imbued upon them through faith. Lord Father, we would ask that you would heal all those in our congregation who are sick today. We would ask that you heal not only their physical illnesses and ailments, but also that you would raise up their spirits to sense such great wonder and joy that can be found in meditating on what your Son has done on this weekend over 2,000 years ago. Lord Father, ultimately, we ask that your Son's name be exalted in our lives and that your name be praised. And these things we praise and ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, in the name above all names. Amen.
Thank you.
congregation saying, "He is risen indeed." So today, wherever you are, as we worship together, I'm going to say that again, and in your home, say that with all your heart. "He is risen indeed. He is risen. He is risen indeed." It is so wonderful to be with you here on Resurrection Sunday. I have to tell you, for a pastor, this has got to be one of the most difficult things to be able to speak to a camera and not a congregation. But what I'm doing today is I'm picturing where different people sit and imagining that you're there. Even those of you that sleep through part of the sermon, I'm imagining that too. But we're going to have a good time today. I just wanted to tell you that in preparation for this message, through today I have read 5 medical journals on the death of Christ, the crucifixion. And I think it is so important for us to not only celebrate the resurrection, but we need to remember the sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross. So I'm going to talk about that a bit today. Friday, my family, we sat down in the evening and made a plan and popped popcorn, and we sit and watched The Passion of the Christ. And every time I watch, I hate that movie. I gotta tell you, I absolutely hate it, because it is so depictive of how our Lord was brutalized. But as I read these medical journals, which are theories, I don't want you to think that these medical journals are scripture. I will tell you when I'm reading from scripture and when I'm referring to these medical theories of what really happened to Christ on the cross. I just want you to be aware of the sacrifice that He made for you because He loved you so much. I want you to be able this year to not only celebrate the resurrection, but to remember that sacrifice that Christ made on the cross. Jesus had come to Jerusalem on Sunday to offer Himself as a sacrifice for us. He proved by His actions in the temple on Monday and Tuesday that He was without blemish, just as the sacrificial lambs were to be spotless. As the priests were slaughtering the lambs for Jewish Passover, Jesus was dying as our sacrificial lamb for our Passover. At the same time the priests were draining the blood from the lambs, the lifeblood was being drained from our Savior. By this unselfish act, He became the new Passover, the Passover of the new and the eternal covenant. The next time you hear, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world," I hope after today's presentation, you will understand a little bit more about the Lamb of God. I want to read to you this morning from 1 Peter. It states in 1 Peter 18 and 19, "Realize that you were delivered from futile way of life your fathers handed on to you, not by any diminishable sum of silver or gold, but by Christ's blood beyond any price, the blood of a spotless, unblemished lamb." It began. The soldiers stripped Him and put a scarlet robe on Him. They twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on His head. They put a staff in His right hand and knelt in front of Him and mocked Him. "Hail, the King of the Jews!" They took turns coming by Him and hitting Him with that staff, mostly on the head, to drive that crown of thorns in. And then they would spit in His face. I don't know if any of you have ever had somebody spit in your face. I've only happened at one time, and things got ugly quick. But with Jesus, He took all the humiliation of the cross. He took the pain all for you and I. Now, these thorns that were in the crown have been estimated to be 1 to 2 inches long. The gospel states that the Roman soldiers continued to beat Jesus on the head. The blows literally would drive the thorns into the scalp, causing a severe bleeding. That's one of the most vascular areas of the body. I want to read to you now from Isaiah 1:18. "Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they are red as crimson, they shall be like wool." The significance of the scarlet robe and the crown of thorns is to emphasize Jesus is taking the sins of the world upon his body. The Bible describes sin by the color of scarlet. And if you remember, thorns first appeared after the fall in the garden as a sign of the curse. So these articles that he wore are symbols to show that Jesus took on the sins and the curse of the world upon himself. I found it interesting as I read these medical, some of them were almost autopsies of what happened to Christ. I found it very interesting as I go back that the Gospels really do not talk about the severity of the beatings. But if you look back in the book of Isaiah, it suggests that the Roman soldiers literally pulled out his beard. Now, you guys that have had a beard or may have one now and have kids and they come up and pull on your beard, you know that's painful. But imagine people coming by and grabbing hands full and ripping it totally from your face. It also mentions in Isaiah that Jesus was beaten so severely that his form did not look like that of a son of a man. In other words, that of a human being. The literal translation of the verse reads, "So marred from the form of man was his aspect that his appearance was not that of a son of man, and people were appalled to look at him." From that beating, Jesus walked on the path that's now known as the Via Dolorosa, or the way of suffering, to be crucified on Golgotha. The distance from where he was beaten to the place of the crucifixion on Golgotha was approximately 650 yards. And you may think that's not that great of a distance, but it's all uphill. The entire journey to Golgotha was uphill. He was led through crowded streets of people who were mocking him, who were spitting at him, throwing rocks at him. He was carrying the crossbar of the cross called the patibulum. And the crossbar probably weighed somewhere in the neighborhood of 110 pounds. And he was surrounded by Roman soldiers, one of which carried a titulus, which was a sign that announced the crime of him being the king of the Jews. And it was written in Hebrew. It was written in Latin. It was written in Greek. So all would know the penalty or the crime that he had committed. King of the Jews. A fall with this heavy crossbar on his back. In one account, I read that it may have led to a contusion of the heart, predisposing his heart to rupture on the cross. Simon of Cyrene, and that's currently in North Africa, close to Tripoli, who apparently was affected by these events, was summoned to help Jesus carry the cross. The crucifixion event is prophesied in several places throughout the Old Testament. One of the most striking is recording, as we all know, in Isaiah chapter 52. In verse 13, it says this, "My servant will act wisely or prosper. He will be raised and lifted up and greatly exalted." And then I love this. In John 3, Jesus talks about the fulfillment of that prophecy when he says, "Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, So the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. He refers to the events recorded in Numbers chapter 21. If you remember, the Lord, in that chapter, the Lord had sent a plague of deadly serpents on the people of Israel, and they bit people, and many of the people died. And after the people confessed their sins to Moses, the Lord forgave them. And they were instructed to build this bronze serpent. So the bronze is a symbol. This is important to recognize this. Bronze is a symbol for judgment. And the serpent is the symbol of the curse, or the symbol of Satan himself. Whoever was bitten by a serpent and then looked at the bronze serpent was saved from death. These verses are prophecies that point to the crucifixion, in that Jesus would be lifted up on the cross for the judgment of my sin and your sin, so that whoever believes in him should not die, but live an eternal life. I love this passage in 2 Corinthians 5:21. It really amplifies this point, in that he made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. You know, I find it interesting that the symbol for the medical profession today has its roots from the making of the bronze serpent. Indeed, though, we need to remember Jesus is the healer. Jesus paid for healing on the cross. Now Jesus is led to the place of the skull. The Latin translation of that place was Calvary. The Aramaic translation was Golgotha. But he was led there to be crucified. And crucified he was. Crucifixion was a practice that had been perfected by the Romans. It was a method of execution that caused maximal pain and suffering over a long period of time. Those crucified normally included slaves, outsiders, the lowest of the low of criminals. But Roman citizens, except perhaps for soldiers who were deserters, were not subject to this treatment. The crucifixion site was purposely chosen to be outside the city for sanitary reasons. The crucified body was sometimes left to rot on the cross and serve as a disgrace and a convincing warning and deterrent to passers-by that you better obey the law. You better not cross the Roman government. Sometimes the subject, this is really gross, but it's true, sometimes the subject on the cross was eaten while still alive on the cross by wild beasts and wild dogs. The patibulum, or the crossbar, was laid on the ground, and the victim laid upon it, and nails that were about 7 inches long were driven through the wrist. The points would go into the vicinity of the median nerve, causing shock pains to radiate through the arms and really through the entire body. But it's important to know that it's possible, and it is, I believe, a fact that these nails, as they were driven into the wrist of Christ, broke no bones, so that it would fit with the prophecies that had been foretold. Studies have shown that the nails were probably driven right between the small bones, since, you know, we've all seen the pictures of the nails in Christ palms, but the hands would not support the weight of the body when they were lifted up on the cross. In ancient terminology, it's really important to understand that the wrist was considered to be part of the hand. Now, standing at the crucifixion sites would be these upright pillars called stipes. They would stand about 7 foot tall, and in the center of the stipes was a crude, very small sedulum, which served as a support for the victim. The patibulum, or the crossbar, was lifted up to the stipes, and the feet were nailed to the stipes. To allow for this, the knees had to be bent, rotated, being left in a very, very uncomfortable and a very difficult position. The titulus, or the sign, was hung above the victim's head. Having suffered from the beatings and floggings Jesus suffered, as I read these medical journals, from severe hypovolemia, from loss of blood. He was in an extreme dehydrated state and was losing his strength. When the cross was erected upright, there was a tremendous strain put on the wrists and the arms and the shoulders, resulting in a dislocation of the shoulder and the elbow joints very often. The arms being held up and outward held the rib cage in a fixed and difficult, very, very difficult position for the victim to exhale, and impossible to take a full breath. The victim would only be able to take very shallow breaths. And this may explain why Jesus' statements from the cross were very short and to the point. Now, as time passed, the loss of blood, loss of oxygen, and this fixed position of the body would cause the muscles to undergo severe cramping. Have you ever had cramps in your legs? If you ever have had the cramps in your legs, and you think that really was painful, imagine being nailed to a cross, causing cramping and spasmodic contractions that often left people passing out. Matthew 27:46, which Matt read earlier, about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, my God, why have you forsaken me?" With the sin of the world on him, Jesus suffered spiritual death, separation from the Father. Isaiah 59:2 says that sins cause a separation from God, and that he hides his face from us. He hides his face from sin. Can you imagine the difficulty? The Father must turn away from his beloved Son on the cross. And for the first time, Jesus does not address God as Father. Now, death by crucifixion is just nothing but slow suffocation. First, there is shallowness of breathing that causes the lungs to begin to collapse. Next, decreased oxygen and increased carbon dioxide causes acidic conditions in the tissues, and the functions of a normal body would just break down. Fluid builds up in the lungs. And finally, the heart is stressed to the point that it eventually fails. The sole process of suffering and resulting death during a crucifixion was horrific, and it was not only painful, but it was humiliating. They had stripped Jesus of his clothes. They had spat on him. They threw things at him. Now the weight of the body being supported by the sedulum, the crossbar, the arms were pulled upward. This caused the intercostal and the pectoral muscles to be stretched. Furthermore, movements of these muscles was opposed by the body, the movement of the body. With the muscles of respiration stretched, the respiratory bellows became almost non-existent. Imagine the pain in the wrist and the arms as it increased, as the victim was forced to raise the body off the sedulum, the small seat on the cross, and thereby transferring the weight of the body to the feet and the legs. When the pain would become unbearable, the victim again slept down on the sedulum with the weight of the body pulling on the wrist and again the intercostal muscles. Thus, the victim alternated between lifting his body off of that small seat in order to breathe and slumping down on the seat to relieve the pain that was happening in the feet and legs. Eventually, it became exhausted, and many who were crucified would lapse into unconsciousness. Once that happened, they no longer could lift their body, and in that position with the respiratory muscles essentially paralyzed, the victim suffocated and died. Due to shallow breathing, the victim's lungs began to collapse. The loss of blood from numerous beatings resulted in an increased strain on the heart. This is one thing I want to point out. Jesus took the beatings, and the other two that were crucified, we don't hear in history or in any passage that they were flogged like Jesus was. It was interesting as I was reading these journals this week, and Lord knows that I'm not a medical person, but some of you will understand this. There's one theory that stated that there was a filling of the pericardium with fluid, the sac around the heart, which put a fatal strain on the ability of the heart to pump blood. Another theory states that Jesus died of cardiac rupture. The actual cause of Jesus' death, however, and I want you to hear this, could be because of the shock, the exhaustion, the asphyxia, and yes, it perhaps caused acute heart failure. John 19:29-30. We see these passages. A jar of wine was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on the stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Jesus, in one of his final statements, said, "I thirst." Now, he was offered two drinks on the cross. The first, which he refused, was a drugged wine, a very, very intoxicating wine. Jesus chose to face the penalty of the cross with an unclouded mind. He didn't take the easy way out. Now the second drink, which he accepts moments before his death, is described as wine vinegar. Two points are important to note. the drink given on the stalk of the hyssop plant. And if you watch Matt's message on Thursday, he brought this out. You remember that these events occurred at the Feast of the Passover. And during the feast, the hyssop was used to apply the blood of the Passover lamb to the wooden doorpost of the Jews. And it's interesting to me that in the end, the hyssop stalk pointed to the blood of the perfect lamb, the Paschal lamb, which was applied to the wooden cross for the salvation of all mankind. But I also want to point out that this wine was the product of fermentation, was made from grape juice and yeast. The word literally means that it was something that was soured. It was nasty. That which is soured is related to the Hebrew term for that which is leavened. And we heard Matt speak about that Thursday night. Yeast or leaven is a biblical symbol of sin. And when Jesus took this drink, it was symbolic of taking the sins of the world into his body. One Old Testament prophecy that I found very interesting this week, and I studied this, read from different books about this because this caught my attention. Psalms 22, 12, and 13. Many bulls surround me. Strong bulls of Bashan encircle me. Roaring lions tearing their prey open, their mouths open wide against me. Now, at first glance, this verse seems to be out of place for the crucifixion of Christ. But I believe that this verse has a deeper meaning. Bashan was an area to the east of the Jordan River and was famous for its fertility. Cattle were raised there that grew to enormous sizes. And the people worshiped demon spirits associated with Baal within the cattle. Also, 1 Peter 5:8, Satan is described as a roaring lion seeking those who he may devour. So these verses are suggestive of the spiritual activity, the spiritual war that was taking place on the cross. Satan and his demons celebrating as Jesus was suffering on the cross. They would not celebrate long. Now, if you miss everything else about this presentation, don't miss this. Jesus laid down his life. John 10, 17 and 18. The reason my Father loves me is that I laid down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. And then Luke 23, 46. Jesus calls out with a loud voice, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And when he said this, he breathed his last. Normally, suffering and death by crucifixion took 2 to 4 days. And there were reported cases in history that there might have been some victims that lived as long as 9 days. But the actual causes of death by crucifixion were multifaceted. One of the most significant would have been the severity of the scourging and the beating that Jesus took. Jesus dies a quick physical death. Pilate was surprised that he had died so soon. You can read that in Mark 15, 44. While many of the physical signs preceding death were present, one reality that Jesus did not die by physical factors which ended the ability to live, but that he gave up his life of his own accord. Let that sink into your spirit today. He gave up his life. We saw that clearly in John 10. He states that only he has the power to lay down his life. He provided his power by, he proved his power by his resurrection. God's the only one who has power over life and death. Then we see in John 19, 32 and 33, the soldiers therefore came and broke the legs of the first man who was crucified with Jesus, and then broke the legs of the other. But when they came to Jesus and found that he was already dead, they did not break his legs, fulfilling the prophecy that his bones would not be broken. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced Jesus' side with a spear, bringing a sudden flow of blood and water. Death and crucifixion was hastened for the other two by breaking of the legs. This procedure literally prevented them from being able to take any breath. They suffocated quickly. But in Jesus' case, he died quickly and did not have to have his legs broken. Jesus fulfills one of the prophetic requirements of the Passover lamb, that not one bone shall be broken. But to confirm that a victim was dead, the Romans inflicted a spear wound through the right side of the heart. And when pierced, a sudden flow of blood and water came from Jesus' body. It's interesting, this has been talked about for ages. And you got to understand, these are theories. But one of them died, one of them said Jesus died of, the medical term would be a massive myocardial infarction, which the heart ruptured. He died of a broken heart. Another theory states that Jesus' heart was surrounded by fluid in the pericardium, which constricted the heart and caused death. The physical stress of his beatings and his treatment by the Roman soldiers made it difficult for him to breathe. It may have produced this fatal cardiac event. Now, think about this for a minute. The stated order of blood and water may not necessarily indicate the order of appearance, but rather the prominence of each fluid. In this case, the spear went through the right side of the heart, which would allow the fluid in the lungs to escape first, which would have the appearance of water, followed by a flow of blood from the wall of the right ventricle. But the most important fact here for us to pause and think about here today, and to be sure that you understand this, is that Jesus did die a physical death. There's been people for ages, ever since the crucifixion, that I have tried to say that Jesus did not actually die, but he did. Revelation 5, verse 6 says this, "When I saw a lamb looking as if it had been slain, standing in the center of the throne, encircled by the four living creatures and the elders." In eternity, Jesus will bear the marks of his crucifixion. Revelation 5, 6 suggests that he appears in heaven with the marks as a lamb looking as if it had been slain. Jesus died. But this is not the end of the story. We're here today to celebrate the fact that he rose again. He was buried in a borrowed tomb, sealed by the Roman guards. Roman guards placed there so nobody could steal the body or desecrate it in any way. And yet on Sunday, he rose again. He came back to life. He spent some time on earth speaking to and being with his disciples and his followers. But he ascended into heaven and now is at the right hand of the Father. And I've told you all of this to tell you this. Jesus went through a horrible death for one reason. Because your sins and my sins had to have a blood sacrifice for us to have eternal life. And Jesus was willing to do that. If you're listening today, maybe you're not even a part of our congregation, know this, that Jesus loved you so much that he went through the punishment of the cross and rose again, victorious over death, hell, and the grave. He is risen. He did that for you because he loves you that much. He wants you to be in his eternal home that he prepares for those who accept the sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross. I pray that if you have not accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you've not accepted that sacrifice, that today you would pray a prayer asking the Lord to forgive you of your sins and ask him to come into your heart and to change you and to become real to you. Because he is alive and his spirit dwells within us. And very soon he's coming back to get those who have accepted that gift of salvation. I can't understand why anybody would not want to accept that gift. But I'm asking you today, if you have not accepted it, please know that Jesus went through death on the cross so that you could have eternal life. Let's pray. Father, we thank you today that you gave your son. I can't even imagine how difficult. I could not do that, Lord. I could not give one of my children the life of one of my kids for anybody else. And yet, you gave the life of Jesus Christ so that we could have eternal life. Lord, I pray that if anyone listening today has not accepted that free gift, that today they would accept that gift of salvation and would know that you are living in their hearts. And I pray this in Jesus' name. It's difficult to celebrate the resurrection without embracing the cross. I love you. Love every one of you. God bless you. And now we're going to lead you in communion. So if you need to pause, hit pause and get your crackers, your bread, and your wine or your juice, whatever you're using, so that we can celebrate the broken body and the spilt blood of Christ together today. He loves you.
Thank you.
Confessed, so do we now confess our sins and shortcomings to you. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion. Blot out my transgressions, wash away all my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Well, now I pray that you have got your elements and are ready for communion. And before we partake, I do want to read a passage of scripture that again points to Christ's sacrifice, and it comes from Isaiah 53, starting with verse number 4. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows. Yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He paid the price. We're going to celebrate the body and the blood of Christ. And as we do, I'm going to ask Pastor Matt to come and lead us in a prayer of blessing over the bread. Pastor?
Lord Father, we just want to thank you so much again for the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, which was given for us. Lord, how that bread must have looked when your Son held it up, that piece of matzah with stripes and holes in it. How it must have appeared when he said, "This is my body." And how reminiscent must it have been of this very chapter in Isaiah, where we read that by his stripes we're healed, by his wounds we're healed, and how, Lord, that must have connected so well with his body and the suffering he was about to undergo for us, for our sins. Lord Father, once again, we just want to praise your name and for your willingness to give up your only begotten Son on behalf of us. And Lord, also continue to please heal us, those who are sick in our congregation and their family members. Lord, please help Jennifer Cole's sister, Leanne, help her with her pneumonia, raise her up, strengthen her body, and ultimately, Lord, allow her to feel the love and presence of your Son, Jesus Christ. And we would ask that we would all feel that love and that power of his resurrection this morning, Lord Father. It's in his name we pray, Lord Father. Amen.
Amen. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads again, and I'm going to pray a blessing over the cup. And then after that, we'll partake both the bread and the wine together. Father, I thank you today. As I spent most of the week just digging into different history books and different accounts of the crucifixion, how important the blood of Christ was for the forgiveness of sins. So today we come to your table knowing that Jesus paid the ultimate price for us. But with his blood, there is forgiveness of sins. And that is something that we can be overwhelmed with and have the joy of the Lord, knowing that his blood has covered and cleansed us from our sins when we accept him. And we thank you for this in your son's name. Amen. Now, I would ask you to listen as I read the words of institution that have been used in the church for centuries. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." So we take the bread today and break it, knowing that the body of Christ was broken for us. Now I'm going to ask you at home and here to pass out your bread to the individuals in your home, and we will take the bread together. This is his body, broken for you. Take and eat. In the same way, he took the cup after supper, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. This do as often as you drink in remembrance of me." I'm going to ask Matt now to pass out the wine for those of us that are here in the congregation. And you at home, follow through. Everybody get your juice or your wine. On this resurrection day, what a privilege it is to know that Jesus Christ spilt his blood for you. Because he loves you so much. Take a drink, all of it. I'm going to ask Matt now, if he would, to pray a closing prayer. It's been a privilege to be with you this morning. Again, we love you. We miss you. But we'll be together soon. But let today be a special day of celebrating the resurrection of our risen King. Pastor Matt.
Lord Father, on that note, we would just ask you, our Lord, to remind each of us that we are unified through the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. That whether we live in completely different countries, are of completely different ethnic backgrounds, we are more united and more family than even those who may be close to us but don't know you. Lord, please encourage us by reminding us of the death and resurrection of your Son. Use the truth of that in our lives. Make it real for us and help it to animate us to want to and to desire to reach out to our neighbors and share the gospel with them so that we may share unity with them and ultimately in our mutual Savior who paid for their sins as well. And if only they would have faith upon him, that his righteousness could cover them too, Lord Father. We would ask that we convey that message well. And Lord, also, we want to thank you for the message, for your word, and we would ask that what we have heard today in this service become part of us, that you would take your word and you would place it within us and help it to transform us into the image of your Son, Jesus Christ, and remind us that while he went out and sacrificed his very life for us, the least we could do is serve him and make our lives a living sacrifice out of gratitude, not because we're trying to earn salvation, which you have given us through him, but because we love him and we love you, and it brings us joy and bringing glory to your name and making your Son known. It's in his things we praise and ask these things, Lord Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, the name above all names. Amen.
Again, we love you. We'll see you soon. But the most important thing today is he is risen.
Amen.
He is risen indeed. God bless you.
Oh,